Hello, good morning. Welcome to this week's Learn with Lorna, episode number 160. My name is Lorna Steele McGinn. I'm the Community Engagement Officer with the Highland Archive Service. The Highland Archive Service has four archive centres across the Highlands of Scotland, in Inverness, in Portree, in Fort William and in Wick. This series is brought to you by Highlife Highland at no cost to the viewer. Highlife Highland is a charity registered in Scotland, and there's no payment or subscription required to take part in this series of talks. But if you're able to donate towards our work, then we're very, very grateful for that. And I have pinned a link to be able to do that within the comments of this film. So we're back live again this week for episode 160. Just out of interest, could you let me know if you've watched from the beginning or if you've only seen one or two or if you're new? It's just really, like I say, purely for my own interest to see who's here and where they're from. It was lovely. Last week I was speaking to a group of people in Canada, and amazing there just to hear people saying that they had watched the films and that they had been following up their own research based on some of the things said. So it's lovely to hear. So as I say, this week back live again. I hope you've enjoyed the two pre-recorded ones on Caithness Police and on the McCall Collection in Lochaber. As I said at the time, going from the very north of our area to the very south. And this week we're looking at an entirely different subject across our offices, something which spans the Highlands and Scotland and the UK and further afield, women's institutes. And that is an overarching term. I will break that down a little bit more shortly. If anyone is a member of a women's institute or a women's group, please do let me know. I quite often speak to women's institutes groups, Scottish Women's Institute and various other women's groups. So if you are, please do give a shout out and I'll say hello to you. So I'm going to cover some of the story of some of the WI or SWRI records that we have. The Women's Institutes, for anyone who doesn't know, are organisations which seek to bring women together. They can be women across generations, across experiences, across backgrounds, across cultures, to meet together, to learn from each other as well. And they often have an aim of supporting women and enabling change and improvement of quality of life. The WI in England and Wales is run separately from the SWI in Scotland and also, of course, separately from those overseas, but they share a similar structure. Local groups which meet across the country, which then form at a regional level a federation, which then come under a head office. The WI, the SWI and those other groups have a shared history, and that's where I'm going to start, in the 1890s, with an overview of how this movement started. And talking about speaking to a group in Canada last week, the WI movement, or most of the roots of those organisations, are in Canada. Although, interestingly, they were inspired in structure by the system of women's guilds in the Church of Scotland. A lady called Adelaide Hoodless was one of the people involved in the earliest days of the Women's Institute movement. She was involved partly through her husband's role. He was involved in education in Canada, and she became involved in supporting and promoting women's education and practical skills. And as a result of supporting him and his work, she started to give talks to suggest ways that women could be more involved in education. And one of the talks that she gave was to a Farmers Institute in Ontario in December 1896, in which she called for domestic education for women in rural areas. And one of those people in the audience was Erland Lee, who asked her to speak at a ladies' night. And it was at that meeting that the foundations were laid that led to the creation of the first Women's Institute in Stony Creek, Ontario, kind of as an equivalent to the Farmers Institute. And interestingly, the word institute was chosen very deliberately to imply an educational group and something that would be permanent. The movement very quickly grew in strength, and over the following decades more and more groups sprung up in different places and then in different countries. And in 1915, the first women's institute in Britain was formed in Anglesey, in the United Kingdom. In Ireland, it was formed in 1910. And this was followed by, in 1917, by the first Scottish WI, which was founded in Longniddry, 1917, by an absolutely fascinating woman. She sounds extraordinary. I didn't have time to pursue her particularly, and as I say, she's based in the south of England anyway, south of Scotland anyway, so not in our collections. But if you're interested, please do go on and research Catherine Hogg Blair. I just found her very interesting sounding. She was a suffragette. Her husband was incredibly supportive of the women's movement, and he quit his job with the Liberal Party in response to their handling of women's suffrage. She was a magistrate, she was a writer, she was a potter, and she just sounds all round fascinating. So please do go and have a look at Catherine Hogg Blair. So I mentioned that that first Scottish Institute was founded in 1917. And these were the aims. Now, across our collections, we hold various copies of SWRI. And again, I'm using all the terms interchangeably, and I will explain them in a second. We hold various copies of the handbook. And this is a section of the handbook that explains the aims that the SWRI was founded with. The Scottish Women's Rural Institutes are groups of women who meet together in centres throughout Scotland. The objects of the movement are: 1. To provide social, educational and recreational opportunities for those who live and work in the country or are interested in country life. 2. To study domestic science and home economics and improve the amenities of the home. 3. To encourage the production of homegrown foods and use them to their best advantage. 4. To encourage home and local industries, both individual and cooperative, and uphold high standards of craftsmanship. 5. To consider family welfare and citizenship and any matters which affect the home and the community. To help preserve the beauties and traditions of rural Scotland, and to work for peace and international understanding and goodwill. It's quite a mixture of aims there, but particularly around things that might have concerned women, around family welfare, around technical skills in the home, home economics and so on. The timing of the movement coming to the UK was very important. So the First World War, of course, had started in 1914, and that had meant that there had been a shift to a focus on domestic food production and skills, a change in women's roles as well. So although that had started in the 1890s in Canada, I found it quite telling that the time it really took off in England, Wales and Scotland was, and I haven't looked particularly into Northern Ireland or Ireland, but that it's particularly around the time where those, the social structure is changing and the role of women is changing. Many of those who were involved in the early movement were supporters of the suffrage movement. In Scotland, the institute was, the organisation was founded as the Scottish Women's Rural Institute. And in 2015, the word rural was removed. So that's why you'll hear me sort of saying rural, Women's Institute, Scottish Rural Women's Institute, changing the terminology. So the word rural was removed in 2015 to some debate and controversy a little bit. When it was founded, that rural element was central. And you can hear as I was reading out those lists of aims that it's around country life. And originally it was funded by the Board of Agriculture for Scotland, gradually becoming self-sufficient, although they retained certain Treasury grants, including for Highlands and Islands development. Across the UK, after that, those founding groups in the 1910s, membership grew very quickly, and there were thousands of local groups formed. Today, I've had a quick look at the WI and the SWI websites. It looks like there are around over 500 groups in Scotland, and thousands across England and Wales. And they continue with many of their original aims. They still have a focus on that first point in the aims there about social, educational and recreational opportunities. But also they have throughout their history and to date a strong record of campaigning, focusing on sustainability, on craft preservation, on reducing isolation and various other skills and focuses. The records for the overarching organisations, so the WI and the SWI, are held centrally. So, for instance, London School of Economics holds the Women's Institute records for England and Wales. But the collections of local groups often make their way into local archive centres, and that's what we hold in our archive centres. We have multiple collections relating to SWIs from Caithness to Lochaber and in between from local groups to federations. Let's have a look at some extracts from these. And before I go into them, I want to start by saying how much I enjoyed researching this one. I just came across so many interesting things, and I got such a sense of the fun being had through these collections as well. There's quite often funny little comments in the minutes, and it just looks like they just had a blast. Lily, I'm seeing your comment there about the Rose Hall group ceasing to exist, and that will come up as I go through this talk, that some of the ones I'm going to refer to are still going strong, some have closed, some have still exist but in a completely different format, and maybe not affiliated anymore. So let's start by looking at an extract that focuses on the early days of one SWI in Kingussie. Kingussie SWRI was founded in June 1928, and this is the opening entry from the minutes on that day. Kingussie WRI, June 1928. At a well-attended meeting in the parish church hall, a local branch of the Women's Rural Institute was formed. This is a well-established movement for the development of social welfare in the community and for promoting interest in women's rights, in women's crafts. Miss Glogue Tullochard introduced Miss Patton, an organiser from Perth, who had much of interest to say about the origins and workings of the organisation. A committee of nine ladies was afterwards formed, and those balloted for the election of principal office bearers with the following results. President, Miss Glogue. Vice President, Mrs. Fraser Glendarroch. Mrs. Graham Kerr of Greystones, Secretary. Mrs. Murray Delafour House, Assistant Secretary. Miss McDonnell, Treasurer. Miss McGregor. Miss Glogue proposed a vote of thanks to Miss Patton, who expressed her wish that this branch would flourish. It is proposed to commence the session in September. The meetings will be monthly and the annual subscription will be 2 shillings. We can see from the next entry, so that meeting was in June, and they said that they're hoping to start the official run of meetings in the September. When we look to that next entry, we can see that they did indeed start in the September 1928, and that there was a large attendance and a huge amount of interest. And in the interim, they had been busy preparing a programme of talks and competitions and dramatic performances. At that point, there were 800 Scottish Women's Rural Institutes. A flick through the pages of the Kingussie SWRI minutes shows a wide range of events and activities and plays that they were involved in. The movement prospered and continued to grow throughout the century, and in the 1920s and 30s, it was soon to find itself preparing for another global conflict as we came into the late 1930s. Just had been the case when it was formed, suddenly these women's groups found themselves in the midst of a global crisis emerging. And as you would expect, these women's groups responded both practically and quickly to the needs that had been created by the Second World War, just as they had for the First World War. They rose very much to their motto for home and country. We have the records of several SWRIs covering the 1949 to 1945 years, and they really reveal the extent to which the women threw themselves into fundraising and practical tasks like comforts for the troops. Here's a few examples that illustrate this. This is from Glenurquhart SWRI. September the 20th, 1939. A general meeting of the Institute was held on the above date in Blairbeg Hall. Miss Tolmie presided. The minutes of the previous meeting were read and approved. Miss Tolmie commented on the changed state of affairs since we last met. She thought that it was up to all the members to do all that they could to help in any way possible. A letter was read from Mr. Smith suggesting the rural library should reopen. The Lewiston Mission Hall was to be booked. It was agreed to open the library on a Saturday afternoon owing to the lighting restrictions. A circular was read from Mrs. Gooch. Now, Mrs. Gooch is interesting. She became a national figure in the Scottish Women's Rural Institute and was from the Inverness-shire branches. So a circular was read by Mrs. Gooch, appealing for help in various ways. Each member was asked to knit a square to make a woolen blanket for evacuated children. 25 shillings worth of wool was to be ordered from Mr. Pringle Home Mills for socks. The wool was to be distributed at the following meeting. And when I flick through those subsequent pages of the war years, there are entries regarding supporting evacuees, making those blankets for children, Red Cross work, making clothing, undertaking land work, fundraising, sending comforts to the troops, particularly the troops who were from Glenurquhart, sending linen to the RNI, the Royal Northern Infirmary. Glenurquhart, and I loved this one, Glenurquhart even adopted a drifter with five or six men to whom they sent parcels every month, as well as sending parcels to people who had been bombed out of their homes in the rest of the UK. For the 1939 to 1940 end of year report, it notes that they'd knitted 200 pairs of socks, 5 helmets, 8 pairs of mittens, 2 scarves and 8 pairs of sea boot stockings, as well as all that other work. And in 1945, they record a visit from this speaker. June 1945, a meeting of the Glenurquhart Institute was held in Blairbeg Hall on Tuesday, June the 5th at 8 p.m. The meeting was an open night. There was not a good attendance. Mrs. Galliman introduced Mrs. Sinclair, a speaker sent out by the Ministry of Information. Mrs. Sinclair had escaped from Malaya just 2 days before the fall of Singapore. She gave a very interesting talk on the life and work of the people in the Malaya states and told of the hardships those people had gone through by the bombing from the Japanese. Mrs. Sinclair also told of her experience crossing to Britain. A vote, a hearty vote of thanks, was accorded to her for her interesting talk. Just quite interesting to see, not only are they proactively supporting the war effort, but they're also listening to the people who have been through it. The Can You See Minutes include this press cutting from December 1942, which shows the mix of normal activities. Quite interesting as well that they were sent out these two memos at the beginning of the war, one saying basically remember your motto for home and country and do everything you can to support the war effort, but the other one that said but remember that all work and no play makes Jack a dull boy. And so you can see in this press cutting how they tried to balance those two things of still having recreational time, still having fun while working for the war effort. So this press cutting reads, a meeting of the Can You See WRI was held on Monday evening when Miss Globe presided and a varied programme was submitted. Charades were arranged by Mrs. McBain, were taken part in by Miss B. Fraser, Miss Meta McBain, Miss Sheila McPherson and Mrs. McBain. Songs were sung by Miss E. Catenach and Mrs. Clark of Gadoline Terrace. Mrs. White and Mrs. Miller took part in a radio sketch. Violin selections were provided by Mrs. White. There was community carol singing. A competition, Best Christmas Present from Something Old, was won by Mrs. Ross, Mrs. McBain, Mrs. Borthwick and Mrs. Catenach. It goes on to say that as well as all of those things, in a free gift scheme in aid of the Prisoner of War Fund, a doll made by Mrs. Murray realised £1.02. Miss Glogue read a message from the Scottish Command thanking Can You See WVS, the Women's Voluntary Service, for their work of welfare, hospitality and entertainment of the troops. So you really get a sense of all of the things that they're involved in. In Caithness, when we had a look through some of their records, there are references to make, do and mend classes, to establishing a canning machine in Wick High School for the preservation of food. So, as I say, you get the sense of what they're trying to do in the war. There were a huge amount of changes during and after the war, as revenues fell and, in some cases, memberships fell. Because we know that the social landscape of Britain and of other countries just really shifted, both after World War I and World War II. But many SWRIs continued apace, and we can see that in the collections we hold. So just to give you a list of some of the records we hold for SWRIs, we hold the Sutherland, Invernessshire and Lochaber federations and Rossshire Federation, but we also hold individual WRI records for, here we go, Bewley, Kilmorock, Kilbokey, Kirkhill, Drumnadrochit, Kingussie, Kincraig, Kilduthal, Lathran, Merkel, Tarbert, Clashmore, Ballahoolish, Glencoe, Kilmally, Fort William, Kinlochmoidart, and many others. So if you're interested in finding out about these women's groups in those areas, then please do have a look. The activities that the SWRI undertake, I've mentioned there during the war years how diverse they were, but they were always diverse. I really like this from a 1951 handbook that gives people setting up a group an idea of roughly what they should look to do over the course of a year. Institute monthly meetings should be held monthly on a fixed date and hour, and where possible in a public hall or a school. The programme should last about 2 hours and should include the business, the minutes of the last meeting, etc., an instructive address or demonstration, tea, and some form of entertainment. So you get that mix right from those beginning founding aims of recreation, education, leisure, and so on. Competitions, roll calls, and exhibits should be included in the programme from time to time. It is not advisable that a large number of regular monthly meetings should be devoted to whist drives and dances. While the entertainment section at the end of the meeting may sometimes take the form of a reel or another dance, the monthly programme should include a talk or a demonstration and as its main item. So you can have fun, but only after you've learned something. It goes on to say that a lecture of general interest, so they should sometimes take and have an open night where everybody can come along, and a lecture of general interest should be the reason for an open night. But that the people who come along shouldn't have to sit through the business. This handbook, which gives that outline, also includes a specimen programme for the year. And what I really liked about it, and if anyone is still a member of a WI, please let me know if you still do this. The programme for the year as a draft idea, a specimen, for each month it includes a line of poetry. So April's poem, April's verse is "Gloomy winter's new awaw, saft the westling breezes blaw." It also suggested that for April you could do a lecture on poultry keeping, a competition of the best made basket, and a spelling bee. July's was "Take time by the forelock," and the competition was the best girdle scones. For January, I love this, what a brilliant quote, "Wha does the utmost that he can will whiles day mair," which was to mark Burns Night, with some ideas of how you could do that. When I looked through some of the collections we have, I found some that still had those verses for each month, which I just thought was fab. And that diversity of everything from I found one for how to skin a sheep's head, through to who has the largest eggs, all sorts of things. And that diversity has continued to this day, that mix of demonstrations and talks and guest speakers, outings and events. And I should know because I quite often give talks to WIs and women's groups. Anne, one of our assistants in Nucleus in Caithness, wrote to me of her happy memories involving county shows and bulb shows and demonstrations of her years with the SWRI. I was delighted to come across this entry from Kingussie in October 1941. And if you've been watching for a long time, you'll know why I was so pleased to find this entry. "The opening meeting of the new season of Kingussie SWRI was well attended," Miss Gloag in the chair, you'll be surprised to hear. Letters were read, including one from a soldier on service in the East. "Miss Grant of Amfasca gave a most interesting account of the birth and growth of the Highland Folk Museum. It was a real history of bygone life in the Scottish Highlands. There was a household section, an agriculture section, a craft section, and a sports section. Members felt that they ought to visit the museum, if possible, next summer. A garden puzzle was arranged by Mrs. McBain, given out to members. Mrs. Meek's songs delighted the audience, and solutions to all puzzles will be given out next month." I just was so excited when I turned the page and found that Isabel Grant, who had founded AmFASCA, the Highland Folk Museum, had given a talk to them in 1941. And of course, it makes complete sense because that's everything they're interested in, is preservation of craft, of tradition, of local history. Sometimes the records reveal practical issues faced by the groups. We hold a number of records for Clashmore SWRI in Sutherland, including a short history of Clashmore WRI as recorded in their old minute books and account books. And this summary of those books was written for the group's 80th anniversary in 2003. So I wanted to share with you an extract from it, which talks about one of the crises that the group faced. The old accounts go back to our founding 80 years ago in October 1923, but the minutes themselves did not begin until 1930. We started as the first institute in Sutherland, but for 5 years we had to belong to the Ross and Cromarty Federation until Sutherland established their own in 1928. We were founded by Mrs. Andrew Carnegie after the death of her husband, and she was our patron until her own death in 1946. We had use of the Carnegie Hall rent-free, but in 1945 there was a big bust-up recorded in the minutes. The earliest accounts show that the Institute was from the very first was very active socially and held dances and whist drives with dancing just about every second month throughout the year. They also had meetings every month, even in the summer. The dances had live music, of course, four players costing 5 shillings each, including the skibo piper Peter MacLeod and a violinist called Stott. The WRI made profits from selling tickets and from selling lemonade. They had close links with Skibo School and ran the school picnic, donated the yearly prize, paid for the cocoa for the children in winter, and in 1924 had an outing to Inveran Hotel, taking a band of musicians with them for dancing, everyone in a fleet of motors. We did things in style in those days. There was a bulb show every spring and a show of work every autumn, and in the summer they raised funds by selling homemade butter. In 1924, their cash in hand was £13 6 shillings, and they were saving up to buy a sewing machine and laid aside 8 guineas for that. When they eventually bought it, it must have been a cheap model, as it was always needing very expensive repairs. And so to the great crisis. It was just before VE Day at the very end of the war. The Federation had asked for support for the Sutherland Nursing Association, so Clashmore decided to have a whist drive and dance to raise their contribution. Arrangements were made, and the president, Mrs. Cowie, and the treasurer, Mrs. B. Grant, were appointed to go to the Skibo Estate Office and inquire if the hall would be available for the entertainment. They must have got a flea in their ear, as 2 days later there was an emergency meeting of all members. Mrs. Cowie said that the hall was refused for the entertainment, even though it was in aid of the Nursing Association, and other arrangements would have to be made. Feelings evidently ran high, as it was formally minuted that if the hall was not suitable for the Nursing Association, then it was not suitable for the SWRI, and the members would be happier elsewhere. The secretary was asked to write to the Director of Education and inquire if the Skibo Public School would be available for future meetings. Dances and entertainments would transfer to the Territorial Hall in Dornoch. And so they shook the dust of the Carnegie Hall off their feet and transferred to Skibo School, which was freezing cold. Pretty soon they were arranging for better heating with paraffin stoves and better lighting, paraffin lamps, and paying for supplies of paraffin, meths, mantles, and glass funnels. It goes on to say the Institute met in the school for 2 years, and it was May 1947 before they returned to the Carnegie Hall. A new factor had been appointed at Skibo after the death of Mrs. Carnegie the previous year, and relations with him seemed to have been better. The quarrel seems to have been with the old factor and the estate office, and Mrs. Cowie seems to have been pretty fiery. That entry references the need at the beginning for Clashmore to attend the Ross and Cromarty Federation before there was a Sutherland group, and we see that issue elsewhere as well. The first SWRI formed in Caithness was in Keith's in July 1918, with Miss Adelaide Bay Robertson of Keith's Castle very instrumental in its formation. But really, it's the Dunnet branch formed in November 1918, which is considered to be the oldest because of its continuity. But a similar situation arose, as had been recorded there in Sutherland. Caithness needed its own federation and didn't have enough groups. But by 1921, there were six groups and they were able to form a federation. So I've looked at some of the different ones across the country, talked about some of the activities, particularly around war effort and things that are just fun and lighthearted. But I wanted to finish by coming forward quite a few years to look at some records from Kincraig SWRI in the 1980s and 90s. And I deliberately wanted to finish with this because that's where I grew up, and I thought, I wonder if I'll find names of people that I know and people that I remember from childhood in there. So I hope you'll forgive me for indulging in this, but also I hope this will illustrate how you can find family history and local history in places you might not even expect to find it. So this is from November the 4th, 1993, of Kincraig SWRI. Mrs. I. Curry presided at our November meeting held in the Church Hall, Kincraig. Mrs. Galloway had the 1994 calendar ordered by members. The Federation newsletter was read. Members had brought along sheets and towels, etc., for the collections for Bosnia. Interesting there, that continued support of conflict. Not support of conflict, support of people suffering from conflict. The whist drive had been held in the Ossian Tea Shop, the date having been changed to November the 3rd. Thanks to Mrs. Ramage, also members had made cakes and sandwiches. Gave prizes out. As this was the last time we'll be able to hold a whist drive in the Ossian Tea Shop, it was decided to give Mrs. Ramage a small gift in our appreciation for all her kindness to our institute. £45 was raised. The secretary was asked to write to the MP to lodge members' protest at the health board proposal to close St Vincent and Ian Charles hospitals. A competition for a handmade Christmas present costing no more than £3 was won by Mrs. Curry. Miss Carr said a small gift has been given to Mrs. Ramage for her kindness, and Mrs. Ramage had sent her thanks. Now, several things to pull out of this one. That reference to Bosnia and the support for people suffering from conflict. The continuity of the whist drive and also the competition element. And the campaigning element of the members writing to the MP to comment on health board proposed closures. But really, the reason I chose that extract is because Mrs. Ramage is my granny, my nanny, who I looked through and wondered if I would find any reference to her and to the Ossian Hotel, which was run by my family, and there she is. So continuing on, as I say, you must indulge me, but also see how you can find out references to things. In 1992, the family are referenced in this entry. A most enjoyable Christmas evening was had by the rural members who joined together for a dinner to celebrate the festive season at the Ossian Hotel. Our thanks were given to Lynn, Johnny and all the staff for the super meal and for looking after us all so very well. And that is not only my grandparents, but my uncle, and my aunt and my parents. In 1986, I found 19 members gathering to learn the secret of Mrs. Ramage's pancake making. On another occasion, it's the secret to her chocolate gâteau and cocktail canapés. In 1985, when the Kincraig SWRI was 25 years old and was marking its anniversary, 70 people gathered in Kincraig Church Hall for a 60s themed party, which says there followed a buffet supper prepared most ably by Mr. Steele. This was my dad. During this, Mr. Bill Paul played 60s music. Incidentally, I delved a little bit further into that and found that my dad's charge for catering for those 70 people was £1.25 per head. I would have been about two at the time. But what I loved about it is it not only illustrates the work and the process and the happenings and the events of the SWRI, but also for me reading that, I recognise every name in those minutes. Those are people from my childhood, that are people from church, that are people from school. You know, older people in the community who came into the school. And so I wanted to share that because, if you have family connected to an area, do come in and have a look at these records because you might just spark all kinds of memories. I wanted to finish with one final extract from Kincraig. Remember that I said in the 1940s, Dr. Isabel Grant spoke to the Canusi SWRI about the founding of the Highland Folk Museum. Well, another person absolutely central to the Folk Museum story, Ross Noble, came to speak to the Kincraig SWRI some 40 years later, and this is how it's minuted. A welcome was given to Mr. Ross Noble, who gave a talk about the Highland domestic life, which incorporated some amusing stories. It was very fascinating to see the different type of homes and the materials with which they were built. I'm not so sure about the occupant number of the beds. As some members remarked afterwards, I could have sat there for hours, totally absorbed, listening to the history of these people and their work. Mr. Noble was duly thanked for his time and lecture, which was really very enjoyable. I loved that because it's a sentence I hear all the time at WIs or whatever else on here, a sentence I quite often see. People saying to me, I could have listened for hours to those stories of the people in the past. So I thought it was a nice one to finish on. I hope that's been interesting. I hope if you are part of a women's group of some kind that you have found that interesting. A real mix, and what I found looking right through decades and decades of records from right across the Highlands and Islands was how much they stick to those original aims of recreation, education, supporting other women, campaigning for better quality of life as they continue to do. So I hope you've enjoyed it. Thank you. Thank you for your comments. It's been fun to read them. Thank you for those people who have replied to other people's questions so I didn't have to. That's appreciated. And I hope you can join me next week where we'll be looking at the curious case of Hugh Fraser, who was a schoolmaster who had a particularly interesting story. If you're free on the 13th of November, Anne, my colleague and I, Anne the family historian, will be giving a talk, online illustrated talk at 7 p.m. on Monday the 13th about the impact of the First World War, obviously timed to tie in with Remembrance. So if you're able to join us for that, then you can book that on Eventbrite, and I'll put a link up later today. So you can either donate to join or you can join that talk for free, but please do register if you want to come along. Anyway, I will stop talking. I've run on. Lovely to see you all again, be live again, and I'll speak to you next week. Thank you.